If I can ask you to sing this last verse with me, not just the people here, but the people at home, at work, as one, united. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
Good morning, Capleville. The call to worship today comes from Psalms 62. For God alone, our souls wait in silence. In God alone do our spirits find peace. For God alone is our rock and our salvation. In God alone does our faith remain unshaken. Pour out your hearts before God, for God is our refuge and our strength. Put your trust in God. God's steadfast love endures forever. Affirmation of faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, and suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The prayer of confession is from 1 Corinthians 7 and Mark 1:15. Mighty God, the words of your Son echo in our ears. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. How long we set aside the advice of others and put our trust firmly in you. How we yearn for the faithfulness of James and John, who immediately left their boats and followed Jesus. We know our fearful hearts, O God. We know how far we are from being able to trust a complete stranger, especially with our very lives. We hope one day to have their devotion, even as we cannot find the nerve to leave familiar paths behind. Renew us, O Holy One, and bless us with your steadfast love, that we might truly live as people who have seen your kingdom draw near. Amen. Would each of you pray a moment in silence? The Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Words of assurance are from Jonah 3 and Psalms 62. Just as God forgave the people of Nineveh when they repented and turned from their ways, so God will forgive us also when we turn to walk in the paths of life. Pour out your heart before God, our refuge and our strength. Pour out your hearts and find peace. Amen. Our offertory prayer comes from Psalms 62 and Mark 1. God of obedience and abundance, you teach us the dangers of setting our hearts on earthly riches. May these offerings be symbols of our faith in your bounty and of our commitment to follow your call in our lives, wherever it may lead. Amen.
Thank you. atmosphere is changing. Nothing stays the same. Heaven is waiting for the mention of the name. Spirit is moving, burning like a flame, healing the broken by the one we proclaim. Raise it up, fill the sky. Chains will fall, mountains move, we lift him high. Speak the name above. Gather all who wonder, hostages of shame. Miracles unfolding at the mention of the name. Our darkness is fleeing, mercy raining down. Healing waters flowing as our lips make the sound. Raise it up, fill the sky. Chains will fall, mountains move, we lift him high.
The scripture reading is Mark, the second chapter, verses 1 through 12. Hear the word of the Lord. A few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come home.
They gathered in such large numbers that there was no room left, not even outside the door. And when he preached the word to them, some men came, bringing to him a paralyzed man carried by four of them. Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it and then lowered the mat the man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now, some teachers of the law were sitting there thinking to themselves, "Why does this fellow talk like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God?" Immediately, Jesus knew in his spirit that this was what they were thinking in their hearts, and he said to them, "Why are you thinking these things? Which is easier, to say to this paralyzed man, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Get up, take your mat, and walk'?" He got up, took his mat, and walked in full view of them all. This amazed everyone, and they praised God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." This is the word of God for we, the people of God. Thanks be to God. I wrote this sermon earlier this week for the students at University of Memphis Wesley Foundation. I was working on a different sermon for you based on Jonah chapter 3, verses 1 through 5 and verse 10. But I just couldn't get past go. In that story, Jonah was told by God to go to Nineveh to preach good news to the Ninevites. And Jonah didn't go because he knew that if he went and preached to the people would repent, and he didn't think they deserved the grace of God. Unlike Jonah, I know that we all deserve the grace of God, and that if we will answer the call to follow where God leads us, grace comes by confessing our sins so that we can repent and believe the good news that we are forgiven. Let us pray. Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. For you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. A story is told of a day when four friends came by to check on a friend who was paralyzed. Because he was immobile, he likely suffered from unemployment or underemployment, inadequate access to health care, to food, to education, and limited access to community. Each of the friends had probably been trying to help the paralytic man on their own, addressing his needs by bringing to bear their gifts and their abilities. Maybe one would come some days and take him to beg by the side of the road. Maybe another would come every once in a while and lay him by the pool at Bethsaida, where the legend had it that an angel would come down into the pool and stir up the water. The first person into the pool after the water had been stirred up was made well from whatever disease with which he was afflicted. Maybe another would cook for him on occasion. Maybe the other would come by just to talk or maybe just to pray. On this particular day, the four friends all showed up at the same time. Maybe they all had the idea that Jesus might be able to help their paralyzed friend if they could just get him there. Jesus had developed quite a reputation for exorcising demons, healing sickness and disease. The four of them put their friend on a stretcher. Adam Hamilton, the pastor of Church of the Resurrection, calls the four friends stretcher bearers. When they got there, the house was full and there was a line out the door. Determined, the friends carried the paralytic up onto the roof, dug through the sticks and the straw and the mud and all the stuff that was holding the roof together, and they lowered him into the middle of the room. The scriptures say when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." For me, the story takes a slight detour with these teachers of the law who accuse Jesus of blasphemy. But before we even go there, I'm back here with the four friends, the stretcher bearers, with the words, "Your sins are forgiven," ringing in my ears. You see, forgiveness is not why the four friends put him on a stretcher and carried him to that house. They came so that they would not have to take him back on a stretcher. They came in hopes that this would be the last time that they would have to carry him anywhere or bring him anything. They may have even come to Jesus under the assumption that their friend was paralyzed through no fault of his own. They expected physical healing, but what they get is, "Your sins are forgiven." So I imagine that they were confused and maybe a little bit disappointed while these teachers of the law are debating whether Jesus even has the authority to forgive sins. And Jesus knows what they are thinking, but Jesus also knows there's a difference between treating systems and addressing symptoms. Sin is a systems problem, and paralysis is a symptom. Now imagine that the paralyzed friend's name is America. Imagine all the stretcher bearers who have gone before us and those who are even now using their gifts and talents and abilities to try to help America to live into its calling. Many of us spend a lot of time reflecting on the work and ministry of a Baptist preacher, Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr., who cast Jesus' vision of forgiveness over an America paralyzed by a systemic and symptomatic commitment to the sin of racism, white supremacy, and oppression. King envisioned an America that would repent of this sin and create a country whose democratic principles made room for the equity and flourishing of all people. He worked to challenge systems so that the systems of voter suppression, discrimination in housing, access to health care, jobs, education, public accommodations would also be healed. Dr. King dreamed that America would not only hear the word of forgiveness, but respond with repentance, turn from its sin and be formed into a new creation. He called it the beloved community. Dr. King and the people he gathered time and time again to hold America accountable were stretcher bearers. Social activist, writer, and historian Vincent Harding was a stretcher bearer. He asked the question, is America possible? Is the America we were all taught to believe in from the time we were old enough to go to school possible? He often said that even our so-called post-racial America is still a developing nation in its commitment to be a multiracial, multi-ethnic, multi-religious, democratic society. Last week, another stretcher bearer, professor and anti-racism activist Dr. Ibram Kendi, wrote an article entitled, "Denial is the Heartbeat of America. When have Americans been willing to admit who we are?" Written in response to the many politicians and others who, after the storming of the U.S. Capitol building, claimed, "This is not America. This is not who we are." Dr. Kendi argues, "This is exactly who we are. It is who we've always been, and what happened on January the 6th isn't the worst thing that America has done." The heartbeat of America is denial. It is what keeps the sin of racism, white supremacy, and oppression alive. Kendi lifts up a number of examples, but here are just a few. In 1861, pro-slavery insurrectionists assembled at the U.S. Capitol to stop the counting of electoral votes for Abraham Lincoln. On Easter Sunday, 1873, white terrorists overthrew the local government of Colfax, Louisiana, massacring about 150 people. In 1874, on Election Day, in Alabama's Barber County, white terrorists rioted, destroyed ballot boxes, wounded and killed Black voters, securing victories for their candidates. In 1921, white supremacists murdered hundreds of Black residents in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and destroyed their prosperous Greenwood district, known affectionately as Black Wall Street. In 1956, from Little Rock, Arkansas to Boston, Massachusetts, white Americans mobbed Black school children and college students who integrated schools. In the 1960s, white Americans spat on and beat up college students, teachers, sanitation workers, mothers, fathers, and grandparents who protested peacefully for civil rights. And just as you saw the Jesus 2020 and the Jesus Saves flag being waved during the insurrection, Christianity, white supremacy, racial injustice, and oppression are an intricately woven web. Sanaya Key is a minister and social activist in Fort Smith, Arkansas, who speaks boldly about the complexity of white supremacy. She uses a piece of paper torn into three sections. She balls up the first section and calls it white supremacy. Then she balls the second section over the first and calls it Christianity. And then balls the third section over them both and says, "This is America." There are so many tendons and nerves and veins that it requires the skill of surgeons working every single day and night to unravel and untangle and dismantle them. This is America, where even the church looks the other way when acts of police brutality against Black and brown people go unpunished. This is America, when the church is silent on the overrepresentation of Black and brown people in the prison industrial complex. This is America, which has finally, at least on paper, stopped discriminating against and oppressing persons who are identifying as LGBTQIA+, while many churches and many church people still do. This is America. What if we, who claim the name Christian, use the word of God to say that Jesus saw the faith of the stretcher bearers, of Dr. King, Dr. Harding, Dr. Kendi, Black Lives Matter, showing up for racial justice, you and me, the faith of an entire community surrounding America and helped her hear the words, "You are forgiven. Your sins are forgiven, America." Not so that we can continue to be who we are all Americans. Not so that we can continue to be who we have been in denial about the pain and suffering that we are causing, paralyzed under the weight of sin so intricately woven that it's almost impossible to unravel, much less dismantle. Jesus says, "Your sins are forgiven," so that we can all get up, take up our mats, and go be a part of the solution instead of part of the problem. Let's go capture the vision of Vincent Harding, who believed that America is possible, that a multiracial, multi-ethnic, multi-religious, democratic society is possible. Let's go capture the vision of the civil rights movement and the new civil rights movement, Black Lives Matter, who point not only to the sin and the symptoms, but to the solutions that help a paralyzed America get up, take up its mat, and walk. We need politicians, but we also need citizens willing to hold politicians accountable at the ballot box and between elections. We need the faith community. We need our saints, and we need our big corporations and small businesses and nonprofit organizations that have the vision and the courage to challenge and change the systems. We need groups like Memphis Interfaith Community of Action and Hope, better known as MICA. And we need voter education projects like Up the Vote. Finally, the most important work is the work we do on ourselves. Each of us needs to have the courage to sit in small groups in churches and coffee shops or in homes to hold one another accountable for how the sin of racism, white supremacy, and oppression impact us and may even be expressed in our own lives through our action or our inaction, intentionally or unintentionally. We must be willing to do the work of stretcher bearers, to allow God and our neighbor to help us, help take us apart and put us back together, so that we can not only hear the word of God saying to us, "You are forgiven," but we can also live into that forgiveness with our neighbors for the good of our communities, our country, and God's world. Hear now the words of the prophet Micah. God has shown you what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. In the name of the Creator, and the Redeemer, and the Sustainer, Amen. The doors of the church are open. You may join Capleville United Methodist Church anytime on profession of faith, transfer of membership, or rededication to the Christian life. Please accept this invitation, this open invitation, to become part of all that God is doing through Capleville United Methodist Church, and let's do life together. As we prepare to go from this time of worship out into the world to be of service, we pray that something has been said, sung, or done that will encourage and keep you for the coming week. Hear now this benediction. The Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord make his face to shine upon us and be gracious unto us. The Lord lift up his countenance upon us and give us peace.
The announcements. COVID-19 numbers in Shelby County and around the country continue to rise. For the safety of our members, our administrative council has postponed reopening for public worship until spring 2021. No date has been set yet, but we need servant leaders who are willing to make reopening possible. We need ushers who are willing to take temperatures, attendance, socially distance members in the sanctuary, and help sanitize the pulpit area, pews, and bathrooms before and after the service. To join our usher team, please contact the church office or Robert Weathers, the usher chairperson. Sunday school classes and small groups may meet at the church in the Great Hall, the gym, or outside. Meetings must be scheduled with the church office to avoid conflicts. All participants must commit to hygiene practices, including mask wearing and social distancing, disinfecting the space used, including bathrooms, and returning any tables and chairs to the supply closet after the meeting. Capleville Youth Ministry. Because of the current Safer at Home order in Shelby County that expires on January the 22nd, Capleville Youth will not meet on January the 10th or 17th. We plan to resume on Sunday, January the 24th, 2:30 through 4 p.m. Tuesday night Bible study will start February the 2nd at 7 p.m. using Adult Bible Studies Commentary. Books are available for $6. Please contact the church office to let us know you will participate, and we will send out the Zoom link. The Rosebud Circle of the United Methodist Women will offer a virtual book study, When Women Pray, on Saturdays, February the 27th, through March the 27th, 10 a.m. through noon. Worship with us at 11 a.m. on Sunday mornings on the Capleville UMC Facebook page, or worship by phone by calling 901-522-5545. The replay is also available throughout the week and posted on our church website and YouTube. Communion element pickup is February the 6th, noon until 1 p.m. You can give to Capleville UMC anytime by going to our website, www.capleville.umc. Click on e-giving or by downloading the UMC Go app. You can also mail or bring your offering to the church during office hours, Monday through Thursday, 9 a.m. until 2 p.m. Have a blessed Sunday. Thank you.